Evening from the Ministry of External Affairs in New Delhi, ladies and gentlemen. I am Anupam Ray, Joint Secretary Policy Planning in the Ministry. Welcome to the second Atal Bihari Vajpayee Lecture on Foreign Policy organized by the Ministry of External Affairs. The lecture commemorates the life and work of Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee, former Prime Minister, former Minister of External Affairs, and one of our greatest leaders on his 97th birth anniversary. The lecture will be delivered by Dr. Michael Fulilove, Executive Director of the Lowy Institute. Dr. Fulilove is a leading academic, author, and scholar from Australia. He heads the Lowy Institute, one of Australia's best-known think tanks. He has been an advisor to Prime Minister Paul Keating and is a member of the Order of Australia. Dr. Fulilove writes widely on Australian foreign policy and global issues and is a sought-after speaker and commentator. He was a Rhodes Scholar and has studied at the universities of Sydney, New South Wales, and Oxford. Dr. Fulilove and the Lowy Institute have been pathfinders who have done pioneering work on India-Australia relations. External Affairs Minister, the Honorable Dr. S. Jaishankar, will preside. Foreign Secretary Harshvardhan Shrigla will deliver concluding remarks. We have our High Commissioner in Australia, Mr. Manpreet Vora, with us. The lecture is being live streamed via this ministry's social media channels. Let me now request the Minister of External Affairs, the Honorable Dr. S. Jaishankar, to make his introductory remarks. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Anupam. To all those who have tuned in, welcome to the second Atal Bihari Vajpayee Memorial Lecture organized by the Ministry of External Affairs on his birth anniversary. Where Indians, and indeed the rest of the world, are concerned, the leadership that Prime Minister Vajpayee provided needs little reminder. The objective of this memorial lecture, however, is to focus on his particular contributions to foreign policy, and that he made over many decades as a parliamentarian, as a foreign minister, and of course, as prime minister. There is much that can be related in terms of specific policies and particular events in that regard. But if we are to look at the essence of his approach to international relations, it is evident that this focuses on responding effectively to global changes. Not surprisingly, that is exactly what he sought to do in respect of key relationships and issues. And this is important to recognize and appreciate, because foreign policy debates often tend to become dogmatic and cliché-ridden. Where the United States was concerned, Prime Minister Vajpayee introduced policy corrections that reflected the end of the Cold War and the new global balance. At the same time, he kept India's course steady vis-a-vis Russia, despite the turbulence of that era. With China, whether as foreign minister or as prime minister, he sought a modus vivendi that was based as much on mutual respect as on mutual interest. With Pakistan, he strenuously tried to dissuade them from their path of sponsoring cross-border terrorism. All this, of course, was underpinned by his belief that India must develop deeper strengths at home. This found expression in the exercise of the nuclear option, as it did in the economic modernization that he presided over. Today, the winds of change are most apparent in the Indo-Pacific. It is there that the diplomatic creativity which Prime Minister Vajpayee inspires should be most strongly applied. We are looking at a complex set of transformations that are simultaneously underway. The Indo-Pacific is witnessing both multipolarity and rebalancing. It is seeing great power competition as well as middle power plus activities. Orthodox politics, including territorial differences, are in sharper play, side by side with currencies of power like connectivity and technology. In fact, no other landscape illustrates better the widening of our definition of national security. Given these trends, it is understandable that we have chosen Dr. Michael Fulila, the Executive Director of the Lowy Institute, to deliver the memorial lecture this year. A very distinguished scholar of international relations, he has held that responsibility of Executive Director for the last decade. In many ways, he has been the voice of Australia on the key strategic debates underway, especially relating to the Indo-Pacific. He writes prolifically, and I would particularly recommend his Rendezvous with Destiny. Indeed, given the times that we live in, there are few better equipped to address the trends and challenges unfolding than Dr. Fulila. Issues like the need for strategic imagination or the tension between economics and politics of the day are right up his street. That makes him just the appropriate choice to also address the debate on the emergence and consolidation of the Quad. For Indians, I should add that hearing and appreciating an Australian viewpoint is more necessary than ever before. The intellectual world cannot lag behind the policy one. With these words, let me welcome Dr. Michael Fulila. I speak for all of you in looking forward to hearing him.
Thank you, Minister, for that generous introduction. Let me begin by acknowledging the traditional custodians of the land on which the Lowy Institute stands, the Gadigal of the Eora Nation, and pay my respects to their elders, past and present. Let me also take this opportunity to express my sadness on the tragic death earlier this month of the Chief of Defence Staff, General Bipin Rawat, his wife and his colleagues from the Indian Armed Forces. I was grateful to receive the invitation to give this lecture from India's External Affairs Minister. I've known Dr. Jaishankar for a long time. I called on him when he was posted in Beijing and Washington, and I kept in touch with him during his periods as Foreign Secretary and Minister. I have long admired his intellect and sagacity. And I'm honoured also to give a lecture named after a statesman of the quality of Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee. We often bemoan today's two-dimensional politicians, but Prime Minister Vajpayee was a poet as well as a politician. He was a leader with a hinterland. Both as External Affairs Minister and Prime Minister, his statecraft was creative and imaginative. In his overtures to competitors and adversaries, his belief in the relationship between India and the United States, and his determination to look east, Prime Minister Vajpayee showed a willingness to shrug off the habits of the past and seek new friends and new ways of doing things. I would like to take this concept of strategic imagination as my theme for this lecture. Like many Commonwealth politicians, Prime Minister Vajpayee had a close association with cricket. And by the way, how many Australian PMs would like to have a 50,000 seat cricket stadium named after them? Cricket is on my mind today because the third test in this year's Ashes series starts on Boxing Day at the Melbourne Cricket Ground. Let me say I've attended many diplomatic receptions, but few can rival the state dinner for Prime Minister Modi held in 2014 at the MCG in the presence of Sunil Gavaskar, Kapil Dev, and many others. It was a stroke of genius to hold such an important diplomatic occasion at a temple to cricket like the MCG. The game of cricket is in many ways similar to the great game of relations between states, and I think it contains important lessons for the foreign policies of both India and Australia as we navigate the evolving strategic circumstances of the Indo-Pacific. Like foreign policy, cricket is a long game. A test match can take up to 5 days, although not when Australia is playing England at the Gabba. Things are opaque in cricket, as in diplomacy. Sometimes a draw can be a win. Cricket and foreign policy require many of the same qualities: intelligence, skill, patience, discipline, toughness, and imagination. The most successful cricket captains are creative. They set imaginative fields, They surprise their opponents with unexpected bowling changes. They lead from the front with the bat. Imagination is key. The weather conditions and the state of the pitch are also critical. In foreign policy too, the decision-making environment is fast and fluid. And that is certainly the case today. In 1991, the United States' only rival for global leadership, the Soviet Union, conceded defeat, and the world switched from a bipolar system to a unipolar one. The hegemony over the West that was achieved by the United States during the Cold War became the New World Order. The only option available to Russia and China was to become stakeholders in this enterprise, if they promised to be responsible stakeholders. A liberal international order settled over the world, or so we thought. Now, three decades on, the scales have fallen from our eyes. The contests between nation states and between ideologies have resumed. Cooperation between great powers is declining, not increasing. Unipolarity has given way to multipolarity. Geopolitics has returned. Every day, the liberal international order becomes less liberal, less international, and less orderly. The other big global change is that wealth and power are shifting eastwards towards India and Australia. Impressive Asian economic growth in recent decades has transformed the region and lifted more than a billion people out of poverty. Emerging Asia is the most dynamic part of the world, accounting for more than half of global growth, despite representing only a third of the global economy. China's economic rise has been phenomenal. Decades of rapid economic growth have pulled nearly 700 million Chinese people above the poverty line. China is the world's second largest economy, and it's likely to be the largest by the end of the decade. It's already the world's largest trading nation and the largest trading partner of most Asian countries, including Australia. Of course, India's economic rise is also an important part of this Asian success story. 30 years ago, before India set out on the path of liberalization and reform, its economy formed just a tiny fraction of the global economy. Today, India has the world's seventh largest economy. The average Indian citizen today is more than three times richer than she was in 1990. For a country such as Australia, with an economy that is so interconnected with Asia's economies, the changes in China and India, as well as in Southeast Asia, create tremendous opportunities for us. But if the economic outlook in Asia is positive, the security outlook is not. We are heading towards a prolonged period of bipolar competition in the Indo-Pacific. Both the United States and China have exhibited troubling behavior over the past decade. This year marks the 70th anniversary of Australia's alliance with the United States. Our interests are served when the United States is well-governed, cohesive, attractive to the world, and strong enough to deter bad behavior by adversaries. Under Donald Trump's presidency, the United States was, in my opinion, poorly governed, divided, unappealing to the world, and weak, which left all of us vulnerable to malign actors. On foreign policy, Mr. Trump's actions ran counter to Australians' instincts. Australians are alliance believers. Mr. Trump thought allies were scroungers. Australians are inclined towards internationalism. Mr. Trump was sympathetic to isolationism. Australia is a trading nation. Mr. Trump withdrew from the Trans-Pacific Partnership and attacked the World Trade Organization. His successor, Joe Biden, is not a perfect president, but today we can say that the president of the United States is a decent person, and that was not the case for 4 years. The Biden administration has got off to a good start, marked by more effective governance at home and more adroit alliance management abroad. America, in other words, is back. If Washington's international stance over the past decade has been changeable, Beijing's has been consistent and increasingly concerning. Since the accession of President Xi Jinping in 2012, China has become much more aggressive in the waters to its east and west, and in its relations with other states. Australia is an extreme case. 7 years ago, Xi Jinping addressed our parliament to loud bipartisan applause. Now the two countries are at daggers drawn. Analysts differ as to whose fault this is. In my view, the main reason why our relationship with China has changed is that China has changed. Its foreign policies have hardened, the constraints on people within China have tightened, its willingness to accept criticism has disappeared. Australia has taken steps to protect its sovereignty, including banning Huawei and other high-risk vendors from participating in our 5G rollout and introducing new foreign interference laws. For the Chinese, Australia's call last year for an international inquiry into the origins of the coronavirus pandemic was just the latest provocation. Seen from our perspective, all our actions were just reactions to Chinese moves. China has had Australia in the diplomatic deep freeze for some time. It has imposed sanctions on many of our exports, including barley, wine, seafood, cotton, timber, beef, and coal. Of course, Indians have also become increasingly familiar with China's newfound assertiveness, for which Indian soldiers have paid with their lives. Australian public opinion towards China has hardened in tandem with Chinese behaviour. The 2021 Lowy Institute poll found that, for the first time, more Australians see China as a security threat than an economic partner. Trust in China has fallen precipitously, with only 16% of Australians saying they trust China a great deal or somewhat to act responsibly in the world, down from 52% 3 years ago. I agree with the broad thrust of Australia's approach to China. That doesn't mean that I'm uncritical. Diplomacy requires guile as well as steadfastness. In my view, we've not always been as artful as we might have been. Sometimes Australian ministers and parliamentarians have strayed beyond protecting our sovereignty and our core interests and allowed indiscipline to creep into their public comments. But the chief responsibility for the current state of affairs lies with the men in Zhongnanhai. The fluctuations in US policy and the severity of Chinese behaviour is prompting three important developments in Indo-Pacific security. First, a number of regional powers are adopting a larger view of their own potential and increasing their freedom of movement. After all, no one wants to live in another country's shadow. I've been very impressed by the steps taken by the Indian government to protect its sovereignty and adopt a flexible foreign policy suited to the times, including an upgraded relationship with the United States and membership of important new institutional arrangements such as the Quad. In Australia's case, we have bolstered our internal resilience, increased our defence spending, and most recently entered into a new defence pact with the United States and the United Kingdom, AUKUS, which promises closer military and scientific ties between the three countries and the development of a nuclear-powered Australian submarine fleet. After the fall of Kabul in August, many observers of US foreign policy concluded that America had lost interest in its allies, and that its allies had lost faith in America. The announcement of AUKUS in September served as a powerful rebuttal of both arguments. With AUKUS, Australia is doubling down on its alliance with the United States, while also drawing the United Kingdom more deeply into the Indo-Pacific. This is an ambitious step for Australia, a signal that the country intends to shape its external environment and contribute to the regional balance of power. Nuclear-powered submarines provide immense capability in terms of lethality, speed, range, and stealth. Presuming these boats are eventually built, they will give Australia significant deterrent power. AUKUS is not just about submarines, however. It's also about technology sharing, cyber capabilities, and AI. It reminds me of something that Prime Minister Winston Churchill said in 1940, when the United States provided Britain with destroyers in exchange for access to naval bases. Churchill said that the two countries will have to be somewhat mixed up together in some of their affairs for mutual and general advantage. I suspect that in the face of new challenges, we will once again see like-minded countries getting more mixed up together. Second, there have been important institutional developments in the Indo-Pacific, foremost among them, President Biden's elevation of the Quad to the leaders level. In his 2021 Lowy lecture, US National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan described the Quad as an example of the new latticework of institutional arrangements. Whereas Dean Acheson's generation of policymakers built the Parthenon with its columns of the UN, NATO, the IMF, and the World Bank, Jake argued that today's arrangements are more flexible, ad hoc, more political than legal, sometimes more temporary than permanent. In this sense, Jake told me, the architecture of international cooperation is acquiring more of a Frank Gehry character than the formal Greek architecture of the post-war era. And indeed, the first in-person Quad leaders meeting, held in the East Room of the White House in September, was every bit as eye-catching as Gehry's Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao. It was a tremendous thing to see the leaders of four highly capable Indo-Pacific democracies coming together to progress a positive agenda of cooperation. And let me take this opportunity to compliment India for its remarkable work as the manufacturing hub of the Quad vaccine partnership. The Quad is a reminder for Australians that we must increase our investment in diplomacy as well as defence, and in new relationships as well as old ones. For Australia, the Anglosphere is necessary but certainly not sufficient. As a matter of urgency, we need to thicken our links with other Indo-Pacific powers, including Japan, South Korea, Indonesia, and India. The strengthening of bilateral relationships between like-minded countries is the third major Indo-Pacific development I want to mention today. The bilateral relationship between New Delhi and Canberra has the character of a long innings at the crease. We started off slowly, but now that we've settled in, we're taking our shots and the runs are flowing. 1 year ago, when I interviewed Dr. Jay Shankar for a Lowy Institute event, he told me, if there is one relationship I take great satisfaction in, it is the India-Australia relationship. Today, our comprehensive strategic partnership encompasses regular meetings of prime ministers, foreign ministers and defence ministers, as well as military exercises and military-to-military contacts. I was pleased to see Prime Minister Scott Morrison announce last month the establishment of a new Australian Consulate General in Bengaluru, as well as a centre of excellence to deepen our collaboration on science and technology. But I would like us to be even more ambitious. The latest edition of the Lowy Institute's Asia Power Index, a data-driven annual assessment that measures national resources and international influence to rank the relative power of Indo-Pacific states, indicates that neither the United States nor China will be able to exert undisputed primacy in our region. A bipolar future beckons. In this future, the decisions made by other Indo-Pacific powers, including India and Australia, will be highly consequential. Our actions may well constitute the marginal difference. Countries such as ours have the means to influence the regional balance of power and a clear interest in doing so, but we will need to step up. My challenge to the decision makers on Rasina Hill in New Delhi and Capitol Hill in Canberra, therefore, is to look for practical and imaginative new ways that India and Australia can strengthen our bilateral relationship and together contribute to stability and prosperity in the Indo-Pacific. Let me make some suggestions. I believe we should establish a high-level strategic economic dialogue between Australia and India. We should improve the interoperability between the Australian Defence Force and the Indian Armed Forces, especially in the area of maritime domain awareness. We should increase the level of consultation and information sharing between our diplomats and our intelligence services. Cooperate on infrastructure financing in Southeast Asia, the Pacific, and the Indian Ocean region, and reinvigorate our trilateral partnerships with Indonesia and Japan. Of course, international relations are driven by economics, and the run rate in the economic relationship between India and Australia is much slower than it should be. People-to-people links are very strong. Today, more Australians were born in India than in any other foreign country save for the United Kingdom. Yet despite India's immense market size, only about 3% of Australia's goods exports go to India, and this is almost entirely made up of coal. And India does not make the top 20 countries as either a source or a recipient of foreign investment. As Australia's former High Commissioner to India and Secretary of the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, Peter Varghese, said in his India Economic Strategy report, Australian business has long put India in the too hard basket. This needs to change. The dismantling of the misconceived Fortress Australia approach to COVID-19 and the recent reopening of Australia's borders to international students and skilled migrants will re-energise our ties. I also welcome the news that our two governments have relaunched negotiations for a comprehensive economic cooperation agreement, with talk of an initial agreement before the end of the year. Australian governments and businesses must lift their game, but so must Indian governments and businesses. Australian firms still find India a difficult place to do business. Further reforms are desirable in areas such as labour markets, the financial sector, and the legal system. And I would like to see the Indian government take a more positive and ambitious approach to trade liberalisation. Countries such as India and Australia have the wherewithal to help shape Asia's future. But we need to believe in ourselves and in each other. The good news is that our publics already do. The 2021 Lowy Institute poll revealed that 6 out of 10 Australians trust India either a great deal or somewhat, which represents a remarkable increase of 16 points in a single year. This puts India on par with Australians' level of trust in our principal ally, the United States. And in the 2021 Observer Research Foundation Foreign Policy Survey, 2/3 of young Indians said they trust Australia either completely or somewhat, second only to their trust in the United States. And 6 in 10 respondents said that Australia will be one of India's leading partners in the next 10 years, again, second only to the United States. These are strikingly complementary results, and all the more welcome for that fact. Now it's for policymakers to match the foresight of their peoples. Ladies and gentlemen, we live in a time of great strategic flux. I'm confident that Australia and India can help determine the complexion of the game if we have the strategic imagination to do so. We should be unafraid to seek to shape our environment, trusting in our own abilities and in each other, and knowing that Providence favours those who help themselves. I hope that, like Atal Bihari Vajpayee, India and Australia decide to think big. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Michael Fulala, for delivering the second Atal Bihari Vajpayee lecture. Let me now request Foreign Secretary Harshvardhan Shringla to deliver concluding remarks. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Anupam. Namaskar to everyone. I should begin by thanking Dr. Michael Fulila, Executive Director of the Lowy Institute in Sydney, Australia, for delivering the Atal Bihari Vajpayee Memorial Lecture 2021 and for taking us on an intellectually enriching journey across the landscape of contemporary international politics. Foreign offices are often bastions of orthodoxy. As External Affairs Minister and as Prime Minister, Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee brought here a boldness and sense of policy innovation. In all this, he was ever alive to the big picture, or as Dr. Fulilove just mentioned, to the long game. The theme of today's lecture, Australia, India, and the Indo-Pacific, is in keeping with this spirit. We live in times of many unknowns and known unknowns, both known and unknown unknowns. What we do know, however, and here I refer to a phrase Dr. Fulilove just used, is that wealth and power are shifting eastwards towards India and Australia and the Indo-Pacific region. While the determinants of power and of foreign policy remain constant, the strategies and approaches to optimize them are changing rapidly. Multilateralism is under stress. New and nimble institutional arrangements, the Quad among them, are attempting to fill gaps. Supply chains are being reordered. Trade arrangements are factoring in not merely costs between economies, but more so trust between polities. The notion of national security has broadened beyond recognition. Strategic autonomy today is not just a political or military construct. It applies equally to dependencies in technology, supply chains, and critical commodities, including pharmaceuticals and medical equipment. These trend lines have sharpened during the COVID-19 pandemic. As the waters of the Indo-Pacific seek a new equilibrium, India and Australia are drawn by a natural affinity in political systems, economic endeavors, and above all, values. As two major liberal economies, democracies of this region, our partnership is of enormous significance in the building of a rules-based global order with a stable and prosperous Indo-Pacific as its fulcrum. The rapid momentum that the India-Australia relationship has demonstrated in recent years is testimony to this. At the Ministry of External Affairs, our friends down under get top of the mind treatment. That is why the decision to invite Dr. Fulilove to speak, and as our External Affairs Minister said, speak at the second Vajpayee Memorial Lecture, was swift, simple, and spontaneous. Once again, I thank him for accepting and for delivering today's outstanding lecture. I wish to convey very grateful thanks to the Minister of External Affairs, Dr. S. Jayashankar, for presiding over the event and delivering the opening remarks. The idea of this lecture was his. He has nudged the ministry towards stronger engagement with think tanks and leading foreign policy scholars. And we have benefited enormously from such linkages. I thank our High Commissioner in Canberra, my colleague Sri Manpreet Vora, and his team for being here today. The logistics for the lecture were coordinated between Australia and India by the Policy Planning and Research Division of the Ministry. And I must appreciate Joint Secretary Dr. Anupam Ray and OSD Sri Sumit Seth for their efforts. A very special word of thanks to the Additional Secretary and Policy Advisor of the Ministry, Sri Ashok Malik, for taking on much of the responsibility in most ably organizing this event. Above all, I thank you all for logging in. As we close, just in time for Christmas Eve celebrations here in India, I wish everyone Merry Christmas and convey good wishes from the Ministry of External Affairs for a safe and happy 2022. Namaskar and stay well. Thank you.